Sound check. 1, 2, 3.
Okay, I feel like I've done all the preparation that I can do, reading a few textbooks, visiting a few websites, and learning about leafcutter ants. I'm really excited to see some ants on our trip to Costa Rica. We leave tomorrow.
There are about a million described species of insects in the world, and entomologists would say about 2% of those would be social insects. So it could include things like termites, bees, wasps, and ants. And how they would define a group of insects that are social is by the division of labor. So they have assigned tasks given, usually based on age, size, or maybe even some external features. When it comes to ants, myrmecologists, or people that study ants, they would say there's about 25,000 ant species, and most of them would be social or division of labor. Ants have been around for about 120 million years. And about 50 million years ago is when they started to feed on fungi for food. But it was about 8 to 12 million years ago that they really started to develop a mutualistic relationship and are now totally dependent on each other. The ants rely on the fungi, the fungi rely on the ants. And just as a point of reference, humans have been using agriculture for only about 10,000 years. So ants have been doing it for a much longer period of time. The leafcutter ants are basically a super organism. Just because of that really strong dependency or relationship they have with fungi. And there's about 30 to 40 species of leafcutter ants and now 3 genera. Most of my homework preparing for this vlog on the genus Atta. Typically 7 casts that they would develop in a fully mature colony, and the leafcutter ant entomologists have identified 20 to 30 different tasks that members of the colony would do, again based on age, size, and some of the external features that they develop. The queen decides who does what, and so whether they're nurse ants, foraging ants, hygiene garbage ants, or if they are building cavities for new fungal gardens, moving around eggs, the queen decides. And it usually takes about 2 or 3 years for the colony to develop this 7-part cast system. She will ramp up her egg production and generate 20 eggs per minute. I associate this with like a Nerf gun where she's just pew, 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 pew. And it's about 28,000 eggs per day and about 10 million eggs in a year for about 10 years. It's an absolutely fantastic rate of reproduction and why you can have over 1 million workers collecting leaves and then bringing back leaves and having those specialized tasks in the colony. Wow. How does a colony get started? Well, after about 2 or 3 years, the queen will produce some sexual males and females. They are winged individuals, and it's called a nuptial flight. They move up into the air, they're gonna mate, and usually a female will mate with 5 to 8 males. It's the only time she's gonna mate. She could live for 10 years, so she has to take in all the sperm that she needs to live her life. Once that female's mated, she's going to come to the ground, break the wings off of her back with her legs. Newly mated queens put fungal packets into their cheek as they try and find a new place to live. They'll construct a small nest and spit out that fungal packet and collect leaves to start feeding that fungi. So here we go. I'm ready to start the nest. She's going to start laying eggs very slowly at first. She's going to lay 2 types of eggs. The first are viable, sterile, non-reproductive females. It's a all-female colony. Also going to lay some non-viable eggs. These become food for the eggs that hatch into larvae, because there's right away there's not a lot of fungi to eat. And it's also eggs that she can eat for energy too. It takes a lot of energy to crank out those eggs.
So as the colony develops, those larvae pupate and turn into adults. They're going to start expanding the nest and then really ramping up the leaf collecting process for those fungal gardens.
Let's take a closer look at these leaf cutting ants. These individuals on their own can travel thousands of meters in a lifetime, and basically their sole purpose is to gather food to bring it back to the nest. Now, they don't feed directly on leaves, and you're wondering, why don't they just feed on leaves? Lots of insects feed on plants. Well, actually, plants are really hard to digest, not only for ants, other insects, and lots of other animals. When you live on a plant-based diet, you have to be able to break down cellulose. And it just takes a little bit longer to do that, to get the energy that they need to survive. And so they figured a way around it is to feed the leaves to the fungi, and the fungi do all the hard work to break down the cellulose to make the food very easy to digest. So what happens is you have these large foragers bringing back relatively large leaf pieces. She'll give these large leaf pieces to the next ant. She's a little bit smaller, and she'll break down, tear up those leaves into smaller leaf pieces. This will happen a few times. At the same time, their saliva is helping break down the enzymes of the leaves, basically chew up, spit out the leaf pieces so that it forms kind of a plant paste. A really important step, and it's essential for the growth of the fungi, is to have the very smallest ants in the colony create fecal droplets onto those masticated leaf pieces to help accelerate fungal growth. So in a very short amount of time, you have some spores forming on the leaves, and they're germinating and growing into mycelia. Now this is food that the ants can eat very easily. And I think of it as they're eating the tops of the fungi. They're not mushrooms, so this is the fungi in the asexual form. And they're kind of like little grape clusters that form in these fungal gardens. And this is really easy for the ants to eat. They have all the proteins and carbs, amino acids that they need for life. They're very efficient farmers. I was curious to know how these ants form these trails of foraging for leaf pieces and how they communicate to tell new foragers where to go for high quality food. Leafcutter ants, especially in the Atta genus, use two forms of communication. Sound, they stomp on the ground, and that helps orientate new foragers. You might be wondering, well, how can a little ant make a sound on the ground? Well, one can, but thousands can. So when you have these very large colonies stomping on the ground, it helps them find their way to these new foraging trails.
All the pretty girls walk like this, this.
A second way, and probably a more efficient way of communication, is through chemicals. They use chemical pheromones to little droplets as they're walking along a trail, and a very powerful form of communication. It not only helps those ants get back to the nest, but it tells new foragers where to go for high quality food.
The accumulator bring in about 85 to 470 kilograms of dry weight plant material every year, which is pretty fantastic.
There's a couple of logistics that a leafcutter ant colony has to think about. And one of them is, of course, you want high temperature, high humidity, because you want the fungi to grow and they need that high temp, high humidity in order to sporulate, form mycelia, and really feed off the leaf pieces. An ideal colony has a pH of around 5. It can be conducive for undesirable pathogens to be growing in the colony. And so these leafcutter ants have figured it out. They can distinguish between the fungi that they like to eat and maybe some parasitic fungi and other things growing in the colony. And so they can sense that and they quickly remove that. One of the most important fungal parasites that a leafcutter ant colony has to think about is excavopsis. This is something that would be considered really undesirable and the opposite of the fungi that they like to eat. The nests have a lot of openings for ventilation, and it's a good way for them to remove
cast skins, dead ants, and expired fungal gardens. They can remove all that outside of the nest. So whenever you see openings, likely you're going to see a garbage pile outside.
Hey everyone, I'm wrapping up my vlog. Today this is my last segment and just some final reflections on leafcutter ants. During my preparation before the trip, of course I was super impressed, and that's why I wanted to learn a little bit more about the superorganisms, the division of labor of a social colony. And even though I'm an entomologist, I really didn't know too much about leafcutter ants, and so made some significant leaps in knowledge and interest. And after learning about the division of labor, the intense efforts it takes to make a colony successful, and, so, and for such a long duration, even more impressed. So I hope you enjoyed the vlog. I hope you learned a little bit more about ants, and thank you.